We have a quorum, I think. If it's too loud outside, you can pull the door shut. Thank you very much. If you're here for this talk, you are in the right spot. I figured we'd start off, and since we're talking about Cal Poly related stuff, kind of poll the crowd and see how many current students do we have from Cal Poly here. Four of them, lovely. And then how many past students, alumni, do we have here?
Holy cow.
Yeah, wonderful, cool. And faculty, that was my next one. Faculty or former faculty as well? Kind of, you can technically raise your hand. Teachers, so. Cool, so thanks very much everyone for coming. We're gonna be talking about HF antenna towers. So a little background on myself. My name is Marcel Stieber, call sign AI6MS. I was licensed in 2008 when I was a freshman at Cal Poly, and my roommate and I discovered that there was a club that had existed at one point, but hadn't existed in the last couple of years. And we rebuilt the club, got our licenses, and the rest is history. But 25-year-old electrical engineer. I work for Amazon right now and build tablets, so that's my day job. But my side job is working for Common Systems. Common Towers, they're a local company here in the Bay Area that does commercial antenna work and tower work. So I can call myself a professional, which is kind of nice. And you actually get some OSHA training, which is very useful when you're doing ham-related activities for a number of reasons I'll mention later. Safety first. As far as the Cal Poly Amateur Radio Club goes, I was president for a number of years. I'm currently industrial advisor for them. And we work really closely together and still have a lot. So all the red shirts you see here today, we're all Cal Poly Radio Club folks. Okay, so rough idea of what we're doing today. I'm going to be talking about kind of the major steps required for setting up an HF antenna tower. I'm not sure what everyone's goals are here from this talk, if you just want to have a little history lesson, if you want to have a little show and tell of the dog and pony show, or if you have specific questions, technical questions about a project you're working on as well, I'd love to address those either during the talk or afterwards. But we'll use the Cal Poly's tower project as kind of the overarching theme behind the whole thing to kind of guide us through what it takes to do a big tower project. Okay, and this is a bi-directional QSO, so please do ask questions, raise hands, whatever. I often start getting on a roll, so just interrupt me and we'll address your questions.
No problem.
Hecklers can stand outside. That's right. So rough schematic. So planning is absolutely critical. You know what you're getting into, we'll cover that. Funding, how are you going to pay for the whole thing, a couple technical details about towers and permitting and that sort of thing. And then we'll go through the specifics of foundation, the tower, and the antennas. With respect to Cal Poly and a couple generalizations as well. And then at the end, I'll touch on kind of the finishing touches with grounding. If you heard Kristen McIntyre's talk earlier where she completely debunks grounding, except for the one case of lightning, which is the one that we're addressing in here. And when you put a large metal object in the sky, you kind of want to address that. And then lastly, maintenance. I've got a lovely set of photos about some of the maintenance issues you might run into with the tower. Long-term, having done a lot of tower removals in the last couple of years for silent keys and organizations that are taking down their towers, you see a lot of really interesting stuff that you're glad you're removing those towers, but sad that they're going as well, because every tower that goes is one less that's up, and it's even harder to get more up then. So, yeah, that's kind of the overview. Disclaimer, legal disclaimer. Yeah, zero liability. So I'm talking about stuff in here that is dangerous, that you do have to follow local laws with. So please make sure you research into yourself. You watching this talk and me telling you stuff does not give you the authority to do something.
Please don't
Whatever.
Sue me.
Don't sue me. You can't, okay? I just told you there's zero liability. Cool. All right, so planning. The first question is, why do you want an HF antenna tower? Anyone here, who wants an HF antenna tower at their home? Why do you want one, sir?
Because someone gave me a stepper IR antenna,
Perfect.
And I need to get it off the ground.
So you got an antenna. Someone else. Why do you want one? Yes.
Piss off the neighbors.
To piss off the neighbors. Yes, so HOAs, that's a big one. Anyone else? Why do you want an antenna tower?
Well, because I've got a 54-foot sky needle laying in my backyard I picked up for $2,000.
There you go. Okay, so there's another example. So you notice this theme going on as well with equipment that's been given to you that you want to use. Okay, same theme at Cal Poly. Okay, so it's critical, and the first question in this planning phase is thinking about what you want. Ham radio is a huge hobby. You might want a satellite antenna array to start tracking satellites. You might want a huge HF DX big rig station to do contesting. You might just want a couple wire dipoles with some just support structures to support them in your backyard. And there are different answers for each of those problems that you want to solve. Right. So making sure you do the right thing for your setup, otherwise it's going to be a waste of time and energy. Critical as well as figuring out how that aligns with everyone else. Family, XYL, your neighbors, making sure that you're friendly and cooperative with your neighbors, within the extent of the law, of course. There are HOA limitations, housing association limitations. I'm not allowed to put up any antennas in my current location, so I've got antennas indoors. So there are ways to get around it. But and then cities and states have some regulations and laws as well. I won't get into that whole can of worms, but there's discussions about, you know, when you can override HOA laws that are actually wrong, so you can look it up there. And then the last one is having some sort of timeline. Our time here on the Earth is finite, where you're living is finite, and figuring out what you want to do and how long you're going to let that antenna sit in the backyard until you actually put it up is something you want to consider, along with, you know, whatever life planning, family planning, financial planning that you want to figure out how to pay for. Okay? So at Cal Poly, our example, we had an old antenna tower that was installed in 1974, I think, by the previous club. And it was donated, and that company, Tri-X Corporation, donated it, the president did, and they installed it for us as well. And that was great, and it worked wonderfully. And in the last couple of, like the last decade or so, it kind of started getting more damaged, and we didn't want to use it. We were afraid to put it all the way up because it was kind of twisting and bending. And so we said, okay, no more. We need to get a new tower. We need to figure this thing out. So the main thing was to replace the full HF capabilities. Work bands were optional, so 12, 17, and 30 meters were optional. And then dual HF capabilities was kind of important for us. We had two nice HF rigs, and for like field day and stuff, we really wanted to be able to do dual operator station contacts.
Okay, the old tower was 40 years old.
The old tower is pretty old, exactly, right?
And was it came in just probably after I left, if you say 74.
74, I think. So I think that's right.
No, it was 70
is when it was installed, I think 74, so 6 or something. We can look at the plaque.
Okay. Well, it took a while because there was a bunch of politics.
Well, right, there was a bunch of politics. You had to have people sign paperwork, and then suddenly magically it got installed. Back then, the way they dealt with it is, the only way they did it is that the president of Tri-X donated it to the campus, and the only way the campus allowed it is by having Tri-X Corporation actually install and do the full installation professionally. Well,
We actually had the facilities department.
It was a combination.
Yeah, the electrical engineering department said, we want to do atmospheric, real-time atmospheric propagation studies. And so the campus allowed them to come in and do it.
And then the facilities department did the actual install. Enormous hole for it.
Right, and same case for us.
Which,
so we'll get to that.
We're covering foundation.
Right. So how does that line with others? So in our case, Ham Radio Outlet and U.S. Tower Corporation wanted to help the club. We got the tower donated by U.S. Tower Corp when HRO's Vice President, George Ravitsiotis, Silent Key, talked with the president over there and was like, hey, your brother was a wrestling guy at Cal Poly back in the day. You want to donate this tower to the club? Yeah. So they did. It was awesome. The electrical engineering department chair is phenomenally helpful, Dr. Dennis Derrickson, AC0P. And he was really one of the big reasons we were able to pull this off, because you really need someone in this school who's fully supporting a project to be able to have a student-led project do something infrastructure on campus. We also got a $10,000 donation randomly that showed up on the corporation's doorstep with the intent to, quote, foster amateur radio in youth. And the campus had no idea what to do with that money. The department chair said, I know what to do with that money, give it to this club. And we're like, cool, $10,000. Yeah. So that was the perfect opportunity, because honestly, since I've been on my list since I was a sophomore at the club, I was like, this tower, it was kind of dangerous, we wanted to replace it. But we never had the time, the funding, or anything to do it. When I passed on the presidentship and then kind of advised, then I actually had time to work on a project, and that's when we did this. So started around December, we started planning it. The actual unveiling of the tower fully installed was in end of 2012. And we didn't actually finish putting all the antennas and doing everything on the tower that we really wanted to until mid last year with the 80 meter V that we installed just before field days so we could have 80 meter operations. But kind of gives you an idea of rough timeline for depending on the types of project. This, of course, gets dragged out because of permitting. It's the number one. So, funding. Yeah, it's a big range, free to thousands of dollars for each of these categories. And that's really the key thing to understand. Depending on your very specific circumstances, where you are, if you're an incorporated city, if you're in unincorporated areas, if you have to do a city permit, if you have to do an HOA permit, if you have a county permit, if you have to get all sorts of inspections done, pre, post inspections, soil samples, it gets really expensive really quick. And this all depends on the scale of the project, how tall your tower is, what the engineering requirements are as well. But I mentioned this free here. Gentleman in the back had a free tower. Gentleman in the front had a free antenna. So you can quickly knock off some of these. Within amateur radio clubs, this equipment is regularly going out. The key thing to note there is you have to make sure it's structurally sound, and you need someone qualified to really look into that. I've removed a lot of Rhone 25 that's been installed poorly, where they didn't have drainage at the bottom, and when you cut off the base of the tower, water just pours out from inside the tube.
Oh, geez.
So that's scary. And those are all over the place. So if you're taking, oh, I've got some free tower sections in my backyard, they've been stored horizontally and they have acorn stuff inside them from the squirrels, don't accept them, send them to the scrapyard, take the $200 and go buy some new stuff. And that's really scary. And miscellaneous hardware can be anything. It can be, depending on how far your coax runs are, depending on how many lightning arresters you need to install, coax hangers, all that sort of stuff, and all the miscellaneous stuff that's on top of major hardware. Building permit application process, catalog, that's just the cover sheet. The 40 pages of supporting documentation plus the stamped engineering drawings from the company are all part of the process to actually do that. In our case, we had to spend $1,200 on the permitting process because they had to have this organization, where was that one? This one. They had to do this consulting structural engineers had to actually sit down.
Greg Lampman.
And, yeah,
I actually know
there.
Him.
Yeah, he's still there. Facilities, so he's a product manager. But that sort of thing, they had to have a professional group of professional civil engineers look at the plans and look at the location and look at the soil conditions that we were putting this into to determine if it was structurally safe and sound to do this installation. And they charged us $1,200 to say yes. Yeah.
What you're talking about there is the administrative process the California State University goes through, as opposed to a building permit from a city or county.
Correct, and it varies tremendously depending on where you are.
Well, okay.
So some cities are very straightforward. You can just do an application depending on the height of the tower and where you're putting it. You can just fill out a form and pay $15 and you're done. Other ones might require more extensive complete building permit with full evaluations, a construction inspector coming at the end, and you have to pay for his time and all that sort of stuff too.
Yeah.
So that was the case for us, at least at Cal Poly.
The special inspection is based everywhere if they're enforcing the code.
Correct. And that's another question. So in our case, the tower was donated, the nice big motorized medium-duty tower that they estimated at $16,000, which is a lot of money. The foundation, we got the concrete donated, and we paid for the rebar, which was $500 a rebar. Now imagine that. It's a lot of rebar. I'll show you pictures later. The antennas were donated by the president of HRO. That was wonderful. And then a bunch of hardware, and that came out of the $10,000 and stuff that we were helping pay for all that. So total project was just under $30,000 to put up a 72-foot motorized tower with three antennas, a tribander, a 10-20 or a 10-15 and 20 meters, a 40-meter two-element beam Bushcraft XM240, and then an 8-meter inverted V wire dipole. Student installed, and it was a student-led project, which meant that our labor costs were almost nil. Except for the electrician that we had to pay $800 to run 28
What would that tower cost if you had real commercial professional guys doing it?
At least four times that.
Four times
that's my guess.
100 grand.
I mean, I didn't count my hours that I put into this project, but if you had to pay a professional what I was doing, plus all the people that we hired for, all the students that came, we had work weekends with 10, 15, 20 students helping moving the tower. We had really weird circumstances. We had to hand carry the tower in parts. It's like a 1,500-pound tower. So cost of labor saving, points of cost saving for funding, right? Doing labor yourself is obviously a big one that a lot of people are like, oh, I can do everything myself. Keep in mind, it takes a lot, it drains you. I was only able to do it because, it was a project I was really passionate about. I tried to do it for my thesis, but they wouldn't sign off on that. Oh, come on, antennas, man. But the key thing is do it yourself if and only if you're qualified to do so, okay? So there are portions of this project that we were qualified to do so under the correct supervision. We have Dr. Kellogg from the agricultural department. He came and helped us with the rebar structuring, which we did ourselves. He got them bent professionally, and then we did the actual assembly and lowered them into the hole. We had a professional concrete pumper come out, but we helped with the concrete pour and do the preparation of the foundations under his supervision because he's a construction expert. And then tower climbing I was doing because I was a professional at the time, and That's all those sorts of things, you know, are things you really need to be careful. You know what you're doing. If you don't know what you're doing, you can get yourself hurt. Regularly, if you guys are reading the ARRL emails, another ham that's fallen off a tower that's passed away was climbing down a cliff to 50 feet and fell down. And that's just last week, or a couple weeks ago, yeah. So those sorts of things, just please, 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 only do it if you're qualified. And if you're not qualified, make sure someone's there that can walk you through it. Get donations. If you're doing this for a club, donations are great. Or if you're, you know, if your club has equipment that they've gotten from Silent Keys or something, you can gather that equipment and then have people look at it and help you understand if it's in good condition to use. Like as long as the reuse equipment, you often have stuff sitting around at home already that you can use. You might have that spool of coax that you've had for 10 years that you might still want to use. Check it if it's still good electrically. The dielectric's fine, then you can reuse it. So. Okay. And then another disclaimer. I get nervous talking to people about doing a large project. Never take any technical shortcuts due to funding. Something will go wrong and it's never worth it. Okay, so that's cases of buying like used Road 25. Unless you know exactly what you're doing, you've looked at it and you've inspected it, and you've like tapped it ever to make sure there are no cracks and check the paint and the galvanization and the wall thickness and make sure it's all good, then I wouldn't use it. And make sure it's been stored properly. If you're buying it from someone secondhand to see where they've been restored as well. Okay. So technical details, we already covered some of these. So this really depends on your specific situation. This is something that you need to really research. If you're doing it on state property, it gets really interesting. In our case, if you're doing it in a city or an unincorporated area around the boonies, you might have nothing. You can just set it up. If you're within a certain distance of an airport or an FAA, FCC listening station as well, you have different tower requirements. So read up on your Part 97 and brush up a little bit to understand what's required for each of these. So some ground requirements. In our case, the tower plan, so the engineering, the stamped engineering documents that come from U.S. Tower Corporation, have a professional engineer who's signed and stamped these documents to indicate that these are the requirements in order to use it. So he has certain soil requirements, and in order to meet those soil requirements, we had to make sure that the earth that we were putting it into was good. If you put a huge tower with a certain foundation size into sand, it's not going to do very well. So you need to have a much bigger foundation than that you dig down deeper or you put loud down pilings or something to actually make it work. So there's actually, the ARRL has a pretty good book as well that covers some of this stuff. I forget what it's called, but antenna towers or something along those lines. And they cover a good section to give you kind of an overview as well, and highly recommend that as summer reading for your research for this. So you might need core samples. In our case, we were lucky back in 1987 and when they built the electrical engineering building back in the 50s, they had core samples that were pretty close to where the tower was going, and we submitted those along with the paperwork, and the campus was happy, and we were happy, and it worked out great. So that saved us another, I don't know, $1,500 or something of having to do that. And call before you dig. There wasn't supposed to be a pipe where the guy with the backhoe started digging, but they did end up finding a random pipe of nothing that was empty that was running right through the base where we had planned, so the campus had okayed the site, and no one knew that there was out there, so probably construction rubble. Okay, one other technical detail just to touch on. Wind loading, this is one that a lot of people have a very difficult time understanding. There are building code limitations or requirements for what the wind, like the peak wind load is in specific geographic regions. So this is, I just pulled this offline, and you can look up some of these different zones for what the peak wind is. The engineering drawings for that tower will also have specifications for what wind it can sustain with a certain square foot surface area of antennas on the tower. So like our tower was rated, I think it was like 12 and a half square feet at 90 mile per hour, 3 second burst or something. So there's some rating that they have. And if you're doing anything over that, you need to lower the tower. And then the towers often have a derating curve. So if you want to put a larger square footage of antenna on the top, then you can only have it up in 50 mile per hour winds or 60 mile per hour winds. And that's for like a telescoping tower. Then in any other case where you'll exceed that, you need to make sure that the tower comes down. Otherwise it will take itself down. And then it's a lot of work. These are ones to actually look at and work closely with the engineer. So we actually called up and met with the engineer from U.S. Tower Corps to specifically discuss the antennas we were planning on put, the weight of the antennas, the weight of the rotor, and all those things. I'll go through that in a minute. To discuss the actual details of what was going on this tower and have him approve it. And he had to actually sign off and indicate to the campus that what we were putting on the tower was appropriate for the tower size and weight. Is there a question on that one? Or? So the foundation. So the tower's foundation can vary greatly. Depending on the type of tower you're doing, you might need a massive underground concrete structure. You might not need a lot. For freestanding towers, you need a bigger concrete base because there are no guy wires holding it up. And freestanding goes for both telescoping and non-telescoping types. This was the original base for the WAD tower that we built one that we were replacing. And this is like a 3x3x6.5 foot concrete block. So kind of imagine that, okay? And then this tower, which is actually 8 feet shorter, but designed 40 years later, is 5x5x7, I think it was. So 7.5.
Codes have gotten stricter.
So codes get stricter, right? And it's a chunkier tower, so it has a larger wind area as well, and it's able to support more, get some medium duty. But yeah, it's just interesting to see how that shifted as well. We had originally looked at reusing the old tower's base, and discovered very quickly that wasn't a good idea.
Well, I said one of the note too is
yes.
the actual tower base on the old one.
It's a lot bigger.
It's about 5 by 6 by about 6.
Right. So the plans call for this. The actual one was actually built, and the as-built plans, which don't exist because of the student project, is something like that size because the guy with the backhoe
could back just dug a bigger hole.
So you just backfill with more concrete, right? And that's fine too. And over-engineering is always a good thing for these cases. So in our case, this is one wing of the electrical engineering building. This is our tiny little shack that we have. Our old tower sits right here. And then we said, okay, we're putting our new tower here. Our tricky little thing was we said, we're putting up a new antenna tower, but we didn't say anything about the old one. So we didn't say we're taking it down. We're using the old one in a lowered state, and it's now a satellite antenna array, which is really cool. So we now have two towers, which is even better than one. And the new one is now fully capable and able to do all the HF stuff that we have designed it to do, which is great.
You have a longer coax run?
Yes. So that's a good discussion
point. Over here.
So our radios sit right here, and then you've got about 40 feet worth of coax run to get to here. To the old tower from there is another 20 to the base, and then 80 to the top of the tower, right?
We have that.
And then if you add another 80 feet around here, the total run length, I want to say, was around 170, 180 feet to the top of the tower. So it's 180 feet with the coax. So LMR 400, anyone at 15 megahertz, what's our loss at 180 feet? Okay. So for HF, it's not that big of an issue, a dB or two, right? But when you start talking higher frequencies. So if you want to do the same tower, if you want to do a satellite array on here and you were driving it from here, you're going to be talking like 5, 6, 7 dB, if not more. If you're going up into 1296, you're going to need some hard lining, you need larger, chunkier coax to prevent too much loss. Okay, so we specifically chose that this tower would now be our high frequency tower, or UHF to VHF and microwave tower. That one has 1.2 gig, 2.4 gig, UHF to VHF, and some repeater stuff. Yeah,
we used to have that whole room, that 122 there, that was part of the ham shack.
This was part of it, and before that, this whole thing was ours too. So.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, there's things change. We almost got this room, almost, but so this is the foundation that we dug. So the campus actually did the digging for us. That saved us another, I don't know, $600 of someone coming out with the backhoe and digging this massive hole. We did the framework and everything with Dr. Kellogg. This was the rebar, quite extensive. There's a lot of it, and that's all from those drawings, right? So these drawings, this piece in here turns into that.
Okay.
And you have to sit down, you actually have to read the drawings really carefully to make sure you're doing all right. The way these hooks on the top are actually done, and then how it's all wired tied together with the base bolts as well, so the foundation bolts just go into the concrete. You have to think the weird thing too for us engineers, we think, oh, the rebar is like what you connect to. No, it's actually the concrete that you're connecting to. The rebar just holds it all together. So the key thing is that the rebar is there. It's physically holding the concrete in one chunk. And then the base bolts that you're dropping in, they literally just sit on the top. And it's kind of a weird feeling. You're like, oh, it's just going to pull out of the concrete, but that's not how it works. So someone's done a math on it. You'll notice that we put the base on these little concrete blocks as well. So that means that the rebar isn't sticking out of the bottom of the concrete so you don't have water seeping inside. We actually did put a grounding rod at the very bottom. That cable we didn't end up doing. There's all sorts of heresy and different varied opinions on how you do grounding for the actual physical base. The latest news is that someone does claim that if you ground the bottom of the rebar, then in theory, if lightning goes through the rebar, then it will explode the concrete base and everything will fall down. I haven't found any physical evidence of that yet, but there are stories, and the best advice was just run the wire around the outside. So we had a grounding wire running around the outside and then connecting to the base of the tower. We'll go into more of that in detail. This was the actual concrete pour. So the shack's location, if you go back to here, it's kind of difficult. So this is where we need to pour. There's you can get like a truck into here, but you can't get a concrete truck into here. So the closest concrete truck location was right about up here, about 150 feet of run. So we thought about doing one of those big cranes that has like the big arm, but that was like $2,000, and this guy was willing to do it for $300 from Cal Portland, and they donated a whole 9.5 cubic yards of concrete, which was awesome. So that's a lot of money.
Would you use a pump to move it over?
Yeah, so it's a pumper. So right here, this is the pump truck. That's the concrete truck. And then this is the operator. He's got this cool little wireless remote that he operates the pumper with. And then he runs this primer that he flushes through the pipes first. You notice we have mats laid down on the ground. We have these few blocks of wood to keep the buckles from scraping the sidewalk as well. All the little things to make sure the campus was happy with what we're doing. The guy in orange here is actually the campus building inspector as well. So he was there for the entire pour. To verify, and he verified the samples that we took at the beginning as well for the actual pumping, based on the concrete curing strength that's required. I think we had 3,000 psi required strength, and we asked for a 3,500 psi mix just because it's free, and they gave it to us.
They very likely teach in architecture class how to do that concrete.
Yes.
If you're studying architecture, you will learn how to do that, guaranteed.
Right. And that's actually on this slide. So this right here, this is called slump. The specific, the actual moisture content of the concrete when you're pouring is really critical. This is where Dr. Kellogg was really useful. He worked with the concrete gentleman, both from the pumper and from the concrete truck, to verify all these things that everything was good. We actually took 3 samples as well as we were pouring from beginning, middle, and end. And those will be, we still haven't tested them because we haven't needed to, but at some point it'll be an academic exercise because we just teach it. But you notice when you fill up this funnel with concrete and you flip it upside down and take it off, and then it slumps down exactly 3 inches, which is right exactly what it should have been for this specific concrete pour.
I'm sure they have machines to test that in the architecture lab.
Yes, they do, absolutely.
Absolutely.
So this is the concrete pour. There's the first bucket, the inaugural bucket of concrete, right? And now come 9.5 cubic yards later, I'm filling this thing up. The whole time we have a vibrator as well, and we're vibrating all the pockets of air out so that everything goes very well. I didn't know how to do any of this before, neither did any of the, 15, 20 students that were helping that day. This is, again, where we had a professional. Dr. Kellogg was really our construction expert who helped with all this, and that's really key. Everyone needs to have someone that they can rely on.
See, what are the archi teachers?
Right here. He's the professor of the Bioresources and Agricultural Engineering Education.
Is that part of the Ag Department?
Yeah. Agricultural Education. Okay. Yeah, they keep changing them. So, this is once it's poured in, we make sure that everything's level. The base is installed with the 3 big bolts. They're 30 inch long, I think 1.25 inch diameter bolts that are the entire thing that's holding the entire tower up. Finishing the surface, making it all pretty. This is drying. It needed a 30-day cure period. It had to be watered twice a day, and we kept it covered with a damp cloth. Concrete cures through hydration, so it needs water to dry. It's not drying, it's curing.
It's also exothermic.
And it gets really warm, yeah. So it's actually pretty neat. This pad, day or night, would always be warm. You could lay on it and relax and somebody would back. So kind of the next section. Any questions on foundation stuff? The pour, how long did that take? That was probably 4 or 5 hours at least.
Yeah, all day.
It was pretty much an all day. The actual pour itself took probably 2 or 3 hours.
How many truckloads?
Just one full truckload. So it was 9.5 cubic yards in that, which was about 20 tons worth.
Well, that's a big truck, 9.5
Sorry?
Yards.
How many days in my house? 9.5.
Right.
Long story.
Yeah. So big. Okay, so tower section. So there are a bunch of different types of towers, and this is, again, very specific on what you got, what you have, how much money you have, and what your goals are. So a lot of ham radio operators specifically will use telescoping towers. So that was our old tower and both our new tower with telescoping. I personally don't like them because you can't climb them very safely. Because telescoping towers move and your feet get cut off in them when they accidentally slip.
You should never climb a crank up tower.
Exactly.
Period.
Yeah. Exactly. So, and that's, no, even, yeah, so we won't get into that. But those are some of the safety things, right? So with crank up towers, you should pretty much only work on them with like ladder trucks and cranes, which most people don't have access to. So I personally don't like them. I prefer standalone towers or guide towers because they're one big fixed movable object, which is a lot nicer and more secure from a like engineering perspective. but that means they're always up. And in some areas, especially if you're kind of on the gray zone of being on the happy list with your HOA, you want to be careful with how much you push the limits as well. So a lot of people use crank up towers and they'll only operate at night, so they'll crank it up at night and then bring it back down during the day, so it's not an eyesore for all your neighbors that don't appreciate electrical energy.
What about tiltovers?
So tiltover is another one I touched on here. So tiltover towers, often they'll be combined with telescoping, and what that means is that when you lower the tower all the way down, you have a mechanism as well that allows you to tilt it over, and that's one way to get at the antennas and fix things on the tower without actually climbing it. So that's a pretty standard thing that a lot of hams do. There'll be tubular crankups as well. Those are literally big aluminum tubes that go up. US Tower makes a lot of those. HRO stocks them. Those crankover portions of it, there was an option for this tower as well, but given the location of the install, it didn't make sense. It was another $2,000 or something. So we used cranes for most of the work and the install, so that was kind of interesting. And then, motorized or not. Anyone here have a hand crank tower that's not motorized? Yeah, fun, isn't it, right? You notice they're all very beefy and very muscular, right? So, especially an 80-foot tower, it takes a long time to crank it. So having a motorized system now is pretty standard. They'll have limit switches for the top and bottom that stop it, all sorts of override and overheating conditions and shutdowns. Highly recommended, but it's often an extra cost. For our tower, they gave us the 1-horsepower motor version instead of the 3/4 horsepower, which means it's a little bit chunkier and can handle the extra load on the top as well. And we touched on load rating. That's for wind loading as well as the physical weight of the tower. So here's the weight. So in our case, these were the weights of the antennas plus the mast that's going in the top, because that's something that's not part of the tower. And that's 70 pounds for a 20-foot reinforced mast, right? The rotator itself, and so the total payload is 215 and max is 250. So that doesn't include the coax as well, which gets added into that. Right, so that roughly comes out right about to what our limit was. So here's the tower once it was installed. This is raising the tower up, connecting the two bolts first, and then effectively this is our tiltover fixture, right? So we had the gray department on campus let us use this all-terrain vehicle forklift. It was really awesome. And he came out and he helped maneuver it in place and then actually raise it into position properly. That was a big fun project for everyone. So.
They got some cool machinery down there.
Yeah, they do.
The Aggies and the...
So part of the deal with all the donations we got was getting a lot of press coverage as well. So this is in the local engineering news. We had a big ribbon cutting ceremony where our club's founding advisor, Dr. Harry Wolf, who's 105 this year now, and still going strong. He came out and cut the ribbon for us, along with our department chair, and I think Rob Griffin was there as well to give the club their special service award on the same day, so that was really exciting.
What paper was this in?
This is the engineering news on campus. We also had a couple other papers that released
it. I'd have to be interested to get a copy of that.
That's online.
It's probably online, yeah.
Okay.
If you search for the 9 call sign in Tower, you probably find it, just to guess. Okay. Okay, so antenna specifically, we kind of touched on this at the beginning. This comes off the what if section, like what do you want in an antenna tower, right? So if you just go out to the expo hall here, you'll see that there's M squared, there's next generation antennas, there's buddy pole, which is more moving on steppers out there, M squared, and probably missed some couple of them. There's a bunch of different types, right? So you need to figure out what makes sense for you. Read reviews, eham.net has a bunch of fun stuff. Talk to your friends, see what makes sense, what's in your budget, and what's in your tower limitations, right? So weight, wind loading are big factors once you've figured out what tower, but it's kind of a combination, it's a back and forth, right? So ideally I'd like to have my 20 element, 20 meter Yagi, because it would be really cool, but it's a little bit big, it extends over my property limits, and I need a bigger tower that I can't afford, right? So you have to kind of make a balance. So for our club, we did a 7 element Yagi, the tri-bander, and then a 2 element 40 meter beam, which was right, pretty much, it was the highest level stuff that we could get without exceeding the loads of the tower. The steps up from that would be going to some of the M squared stuff, or stepper stuff that was bigger and bigger wind loading, or more expensive, and we did have a donor that wanted to test. So assembly, testing, tuning, these are all things. They're manuals, it's pretty straightforward. They cover it pretty well. There's actually pretty good support from the companies. Hegain and Cushcraft notoriously include and misinclude parts that should or shouldn't be there. So do your inventory. We had to call up and we had a fun one up here. We had to build an extra sleeve to actually make two parts fit together because the dimers just didn't line up. And I called them up and they're like, no, that's right. We're like, that's definitely not right. So That was a structural modification that we made to, I think that was the TH70X, I think. So, and then painting as well, which is an interesting one. We're closer to the ocean at Cal Poly, so we opted to do a clear coat of non-metallic paint covering the surface. Yes, it will change the characteristic impedance of your antenna a little bit, but if you're tuning it afterwards anyway, it should make a difference. And in certain cases, it could help extend the life of your antenna. That's another one of those heretic things that I'm going to say, so you can talk to your local ham and get a different opinion. So yeah, we assembled the antenna. We assembled the elements individually down on the ground, but once we had them, the courtyard wasn't big enough to actually assemble full antennas, so we transitioned to the roof and used chairs and easels to hold everything up. And then we had both antennas almost fully assembled in this picture on the roof and then ready to get raised onto the tower. So you'll notice here I'm using this wonderful stuff called Noalox. It's anti-seize and anti-corrosion compound for aluminum. It's amazing. It's amazing. You should use it on every single connection on your tower.
Absolutely.
Home Depot has it. It's like $6 a bottle, and it will make your antenna last years longer up on the tower without needing to get rebuilt.
Penetrox
is for removing, so that'll penetrate in. It's kind of like the DD40. It'll take off rusty bolts really nicely. So for tower removals, I love it. For installation, you specifically want something that stays there and is corrosion resistant. So that prevents what prevents from happening is that your two surfaces of aluminum, and you're sliding in another sleeve of aluminum over this.
Yeah.
Having this compound between it means that moisture won't get in between the two. Passivation layer of aluminum won't seize up, and you won't get a weird dielectric forming in between the two.
Aluminum oxide's an insulator.
Right. So that decreases the electric performance of your antenna. Noalox, N-O-A-L-O-X or something like that.
I got Penetrox at home. I had for years, so that this is something different than.
Yeah, so Penetrox is a cleaner removal for removing things. Noalox is specifically an anti-seize compound. So it's kind of, think of it like Loctite, but for aluminum. So Loctite you put in as, an anti-seize or specifically a bonding compound, but also prevents moisture from getting in as well. So, and that's recommended. If you read through some tower books and stuff, that's all over the internet as well. Tom Schiller, who I talked to, he highly recommends it. All sorts of antenna folks, they're all like, yes, industry standards, do it, no questions asked. Buy 3 bottles of it, it's $18. It'll save you having to rebuild the antenna in 2 years with a little bit of water left there. So this was raising up the antenna. In this case, we did a fun trolley rope system because we didn't have access to those ladders. Pretty standard for raising and lowering. It's nicely described all over the internet. And it works wonderfully. I'm a rigger by other trade in the theater, so it actually kind of worked out nicely to have all these things. And this is something I'd done before on other projects, so we did that with the club. After installation of all the antennas, one of the big things to do is check them and make sure they're good. So this is our online log. We use a Google Doc in the club to track various frequencies on various antennas on the antenna at different dates, at different heights, with different test equipment too, and then just see what the SWR was doing. So these numbers made us happy, so we were happy, and the installation was pretty good. We checked where within the band. So if you're doing more CW, you want to tune to the lower end of the band, so you might adjust. And when you're assembling the antennas, the manufacturer will have recommended lengths and stuff for the type of operation you're doing. So if you're doing more digital or CW, you'll make your antennas longer for the lower wavelengths because usually at the lower end of the band. If you're doing more voice operations, then you'll be using the shorter measurements and the antenna will be a little bit physically smaller. That's something that's not easy to change because once the antenna's up there, you can't get up there again. It's really nice to work on an antenna when it's right at like at this level. Okay. Cool. So the last antenna that we worked on was this 80 meter inverted V. I'm still pushing myself to write a QST article about it because we think it was pretty cool. A bunch of us sat down and thought about this and were like, okay, so the old tower had an 80 meter inverted V. We don't have enough wind load capability of the tower to put up an 80 meter dipole, which would have been awesome because we all want a bigger tower and more antennas. So we decided doing some sort of 80 meter inverted V like we had on the old tower would have been cool. The one pet peeve we had on our old tower is that we had fixed points at the end, and every time you lower the tower, this copper braid would be dangling through the trees and in the bushes, and you trip yourself on it in the courtyard when you're walking by. So that was A, a safety hazard, and B, if you didn't remember the tower down and started transmitting on 80 meters, it could be dangerous for people that were on the ground. So we wanted to avoid that. So with all the brightest next generation electrical engineers and mechanical engineers from Cal Poly. We sat down in a room for 12 hours. I'm kidding. And
I think
we figured
sketched
out a way.
On napkins about 20
yeah,
minutes.
We sketched on, we went to dinner or something and sketched out on some napkins. We're like, hey, wouldn't it be cool if, and we kind of did the trigonometry for figuring out how much the length changes when the tower is at full elevation versus all the way down, right? And that turned out to be less than 20 feet. It was only like, I think, 12 or 15 feet, depending on the side, because the building is kind of weird. If you remember,
18 feet, 4 inches.
Total, right? So yeah. some motion. So with that in mind, we're like, okay, so we need to be able to capture that much length on the hypotenuse, right, when we're all the way up. So we did the math, we figured it out. If we took two pieces of schedule 40 pipe and set them up at the ends, we could have a weight that dangles inside and holds the end of this rope. So now when the tower is all the way up, the weight, which is this guy, and turned out to be one of the concrete stakes used for construction because it was nicely heavy, cheap, and fit right inside the sleeve. That would be up here when the tower is raised, and then when the tower is lowered, we're picking up the slack, and then it sits down lower in this pipe.
Ooh.
Worked really nicely.
You know the funny part is?
Yes.
That's essentially how we handled it 30 years before on the old tower.
Right, exactly. So this sort of thing, we're like, this is cool. It's not new, I know, but there was no documentation we found. So we thought we were pretty clever. We used some pulleys. We spent a lot of time at Ace Hardware and Home Depot trying to find stuff that worked. And this works out beautifully. It's still out there today. It's been up for over a year now. Tower goes up, tower goes down. That's kind of cool. One thing to keep in mind is when the tower is down, your 80 meter antenna is now very low to the ground, which means you can do NVIS.
Yay.
So when we do our NVIS countywide operations, you just lower the tower intentionally to change your antenna's propagation pattern. So that was kind of cool. And this near vertical incident skyway red, so you're bouncing stuff off the straight and up.
Straight
and
up,
back.
Yeah.
And between our initial math and what we actually built, we were off by 2 inches.
Yeah, it was spot on. It was amazing. So that was pretty cool. And just some cord at the end, and we have our insulators in place as well, because the high voltage present at the end of the antennas. Okay, so the finishing touches. So cables, arresters, and grounding. So grounding rods are frequent. So if you went to Kristen, who went to Kristen's talk on why grounding's a myth? A couple of you guys here, right? So for lightning, you really want to make sure that you don't let lightning into your shack or into your house, right? So lightning arresters is one way to achieve this. And those are effectively inline objects that you attach to a beautifully, this is a copper bus bar that has a coating on it, and then that's grounded to a grounding system that's pretty extensive. The key thing there is that if a high voltage does become present on the antennas, which then propagates through the coax, the thought is that that shunts it to ground and then drops it into your grounding system as opposed to dropping it into your equipment. So ideally, also per Kristen's recommendations, if you know there's a storm coming up, disconnect your equipment physically, and then you don't have any chance of that actually making it in, because any high voltage present will go somewhere else. So the actual grounding system in our case, this is just outside of our shack. That's a key thing as well. You don't want your lightning arrestor panel. So this one's outside. It's under an overhang, so we don't need it inside a container. It makes it easy to inspect as well, which is nice. All beautiful silver connectors. This is all the coax running to both towers. And then this is the lightning arrestor for the rotator cable as well. And every single cable that's going up that tower, you theoretically need to cover. Yes, this is expensive. This panel probably ran us about $800 for all the parts on it. Okay, so the panel itself is somewhere in the $100 range because it has these insulated standoffs, and then each of the polyphase arrestors, they're frequency specific to, so you had to get some for HF, we had to get some for VHF, we had to get some for UHF, and then we had to get a specific one for the 1296 that we have on the tower as well. And those all run anywhere from, you can get really cheap ones from some of the AM stores from like $20 to good polyphasers are $90 to $120 each. Okay, so they're pricey. The gas discharge ones, you can sometimes replace them, but that money you spent there is saving your $10,000 FTDX 9000 that's hooked up to the other end. And that's potentially saving you if you're in the shack when something happens. If there's an emergency that you happen to be operating and it's a poor weather condition, then there's a good chance it'll be in your shack if there's bad weather as well, so keep that in mind. This is our actual grounding cable, really, really heavy-duty grounding cable with insulated standoffs that then runs to our grounding system. In this case, it was 3 grounding rods, which are all rammed way deep into the ground, and we put them nicely underground and put over them and then label them and everything. because they're kind of in a throughway area, unfortunately. I quote this down here, R56, that's the Motorola standards for commercial site installations for doing grounding. It's a fascinating read. I don't know when the latest rev is. I know there's a 2005 rev. I'm not sure if there's a later one. And that covers a lot of the stuff about specific grounding techniques, different ways to ground at sites, how to test those grounds at sites, using all sorts of funky techniques that are, there are a bunch of different ways to actually measure the efficiency of a ground system and see to make sure that what you did actually works out. General rule of thumb is at least one rod that goes 8 feet in the ground. These are steel rods that are copper coated, and those go in the ground. And depending on the type of ground and soil that you're putting it in, you might need to do some soil treatment to help improve the, or reduce the resistance, the load of impedance of the grounding system as well.
Copper sulfate.
So when I was in West Africa, we did a grounding system for one of the buildings we're installing, and yeah, the ground is terrible there, it's really dry. So we dug holes and then did the salt and cold techniques, so you can use ash as well. This is some of our coax runs. The coax runs are really critical to make easily accessible and weather safe, kind of. So a lot of times people run their coax high, like we're doing here. This is under the awning. All these hooks are really nice because they were hooks. They weren't like full straps that went around the coax. These are actually, I think, Schedule 40 pipe clamps. So you can just get them at Home Depot, they're like 70 cents each. They were awesome. They're absolutely perfect for this application for running under an awning, because you can just drape the coax and you can drop it in. So as we were doing the runs, it was really easy to set it in. It's also really easy to remove if you ever need to replace coax. Otherwise, you're having to feed it through, or you're having to remove every bracket to make changes. We have some slack in here in both systems, so if we ever need to change the connectors at each end, we have to cut off 3 inches. Now we'd be 3 inches short if we cut it the exact same length. So make sure you keep it the right length. And then just routing it over nicely. Make sure you have no bends or kinks. Depending on the type of coax you're using, you'll have bend radius requirements. We used a lot of LR400 in this system just because it's cheap and was good for our application for the frequencies we use. Solid core versus stranded core as well. So the actual tower run where it's flexing and moving a lot, we use an LR400 Ultraflex, which has the stranded center conductor instead of the solid center conductor, so it has more flexibility and better longevity, but slightly higher loss of the high frequency stuff. It's not good.
New cable.
Yeah, all brand new. Yeah, so we bought all this brand new. And that was very intentional as well. Yeah, we have some coaxes lying around with the coax from the old tower, but I'm sorry, guys, for you can buy the knockoff stuff from China. It's Shireen brand instead of actual LMR brand. It's Shireen, I don't know, C400 or something, and they call it something else. We bought some of that too and tried it out. It's not bad. For the actual tower run, those areas that are not easy to replace, we definitely used good stuff. We bought, I think, two or three spools of 500-foot spools at $1,400. So those run you $500 a pop too, so add that to your list of hardware things. So this is the kind of neat one. We've learned about this from some other folks as well. There are a bunch of different ways you can handle coax on a tower. All of them will have their people that support one method or the other. On our old tower, we did, for telescoping towers specifically, the coax moves, right? Every time you raise and lower the tower, you have to absorb that up to 60 or 80 feet. Length difference in the coax. So one way to do it is you have a bunch of coax arms on there, and then you kind of loop it over one and over the other. That puts a lot of the weight of coax on the tower, and they get caught each other. And our old tower had that, and that was one of our biggest pet peeves. We often got the coax caught as we were raising and lowering. You'd be really careful if you were watching it, that it didn't like tug it, and I'm sure we broke some coax, and the shields probably weren't very pretty on those cables after we were done. So for this tower, we opted to just run them. It's one connection point at the very top using a Hellman's grip, I think is what it's called. At the very top, it's like a Chinese finger trap that grabs all the key coax. And then it's just one drop straight down 72 feet to this lovely crab net that we bought at Dick's Sporting Goods, I think. $30 or something. It's a nice net, which means it drains nicely, so the coax is never sitting in water. That's really critical as well. That's why underground coax runs you have to do very carefully. If you do run underground coax runs, you need to make sure that that should never fill up with water. The ends are very safe and tilted over and everything. That's one to keep in mind. That's why a lot of people do underground runs or on higher runs. This one works pretty well. You have to kind of fold it over under as it comes down. Then as the tower goes up, it just goes straight up and releases itself, and it works really nicely. We're really happy with this system now. If you ever want to visit Cal Poly, you're welcome to come by and take a look at any of this installation as well. As being a student campus, the actual motor electronics box with the switch and then the main power switch, everything was locked off. We didn't have to, the chemist didn't require us to put a fence around this one, which was nice. So far we haven't had any issues, but in some areas, depending on where it's installed, you may need to do either regular chain link fence or actual anti-climb panels on the side of the tower to prevent hooligans like myself from climbing your tower.
I think that's a legal requirement on broadcast stations to have a fence.
Yes, so most commercial sites, I think all commercial sites.
Certainly an AM station, you would want a fence around it.
Don't bother with the fence, they'll take care of themselves. So my last sector here to cover is maintenance. And this is one, I've got a couple fun pictures just to touch on. Give you an idea, a lot of people put up their tower and it's one of those kind of set and forget. You put a lot of time and energy, a lot of people are involved when you install a tower, you want to do everything right. It's really, really, really important. This is a large mechanical structural thing in front of your house. If you look online and look for like fallen tower or look on YouTube, you can fill your heart's content. You can watch weeks and weeks worth of videos and pictures of towers falling, antennas falling, houses that have been smashed by an antenna tower, et cetera, et cetera. So it's really important that you do this right and take it seriously. I can't emphasize that enough. This is a CBR's tower base in East Bay Area. This was a tower removal we did, and it wasn't in good shape. Rust everywhere at the base, the thing was pretty sketchy to remove. Needed a lot of people to do that safely. The top right, that was on our antenna. We had, that's on the 40 meter dipole that we had on the old tower. Had a cracked insulator in it as well. Probably wasn't an issue yet, but definitely something that we caught and wanted to know and find replacement parts and be ready for. We did have one of the support members of that did actually have a star nut that broke off, and we had to find a replacement and fix that. This one was one of my favorite ones. This is the Palo Alto Red Cross tower base. I don't have the actual full tower picture, but what happened here is they did a really nice job. They built the tower, and they had nice planter boxes around the base to keep people away from the plant from the base of the tower. That was good, right? They did really well. And the drainage was fine. It was on a concrete base, and those planter boxes surrounded the tower to prevent people from going up, and they had nets, so they didn't climb up it. Problem was, at some point in the last couple of years, someone had backfilled that center area where the tower base was inside these planter boxes. So now you had concrete, gravel, and soil that was capturing all this moisture in the base of the tower. Really, really bad, right? So if you look at this, this should be beautifully cold galvanized steel, and it definitely was extremely rusted and required pretty significant undertaking to do a tower move there. Luckily, it was still structurally sound. It was mostly superficial in this case, but in other cases, you might not be that lucky. And then doing that tower removal suddenly becomes a lot more expensive. You need to get a big crane in to pull it out, and it's a lot more dangerous at that point as well.
Just out of curiosity, what does a tower removal cost?
Tower removal job cost to do professionally? Depends.
Well, if you have to ask, you can't afford it.
Yeah, well, and this is an issue too. So a lot of silent keys have an issue. I've done a lot of volunteer gigs recently where I do tower removals on a volunteer basis for silent keys or families that have that need a tower removed. And otherwise it would cost them anywhere from a ballpark $2,000 to $6,000 depending on how much is on the tower and what the circumstances are. Because if you need to hire equipment, if you need to hire a crane, there's $2,000 right there. Right? So and then you need a proper crew and equipment to remove it, to lower it down and do all that as well. And the same goes for installation as well. If you're not able to do an install yourself, we did this tower was not manually installed. The antennas were manually installed. If we hadn't manually installed those and had free labor, that would have easily cost us, you know, $1,500 to get someone to come out and help us with the install. Right.
It's not unusual to find schmucks like Marcel and me that will
remove
the tower and just let us go shopping in the shack.
Yeah.
we will take stuff from the estate as payment to remove it.
We'll work for radios and lunch. Give us lunch and be nice to us and we'll happily do a little set. And that goes a long way too. I mean, please and thank you, especially for your crews. We did a lot of thank you stuff for all the people involved, all the sponsors and donors that helped out with this project, all that big thank you card. A couple more pictures just to give you an idea. This is actually the top, so this same tower, this was the base. This was one of the upper membered sections. Really nice, beautiful condition. This tower was actually in really nice shape, and that one can definitely get installed again. Just not that lower section, that was scrapped. This was one of the old coax arms on our old tower. You can see the stainless steel actually held up pretty well over all the years. But this didn't, and this was the better one of the arms. So the other arms were just held on by like the two holes at the top where it didn't have anything left. This is the base of our old tower. This looks really bad, but you'll notice that it had been repainted a couple times, and it's all just really superficial rust on this. So an actual physical inspection of this is still in great shape. Even though this tower had been in there for 40 years, it's still doing very well. This is the winch for that tower that's now been lowered and blocked off in that location, winch disabled. These cables are definitely old and crunchy. Cables, most tower companies will recommend cables get replaced every 3 years. Realistically, who's ever seen a tower that's had cables replaced on it?
That one.
Well, that one, yeah.
That's what we had, right?
So every 2 decades. Every 2 decades.
Second cable in 40 years, right? Yeah. And that's kind of and that's one to keep in mind too. That's why I don't like telescoping towers personally, because that's one of those areas that, because if anything did happen, the manufacturer will say, well, you didn't replace every 3 years, so that's not our fault at all, even if it was completely, so that's one to keep in mind. And inspecting those is really hard to do. Really circumstantial and environmental based on what your area has. This is our current tower. This is the 40 meter antenna that we installed 2 years ago, roughly. Actually, yeah, almost exactly 2 years ago. Fun fact, so stainless steel, this was stainless steel, and that's completely rusted. The bolts on the other side look totally fine. You'll notice here, these are all totally fine. These are some of the saddle clamps that are holding the Teflon rope that supports the 40 meter. One of them totally fine, the other one completely rusted from the same batch, right? So this is manufacturer quality of stuff that you're receiving as well. Sometimes these will need to get replaced, and that's only 2 years in. Right, so structurally these are all still fine, but you're starting to get some galvanic corrosion here that's happening, and you want to definitely keep an eye on that. So I visit the campus quite frequently and do tower inspections, because as this was my installation project, I now kind of take charge of it. With a student club, you can't always rely on that continuity. Bird poo. Right? So it's a good thing we painted this, because then that means that bird poo is actually all just kind of displaced off and wasn't an issue. But there was a lot of it on there. So we're currently looking into an owl option, or the owl with the solar head that moves in the wind. So, okay. Cool. Yeah. I don't even call it RFI issue, right? This was also our tower. Just 2 months ago or something? So we walked on the campus. I'd just been there that weekend. And then on Thursday, someone walks up and said, hey, that doesn't look right. And yeah, sure enough. So this one, with the amount of birds that we had in the area that are now, when we leave the tower up, more birds roost on it because they can see further. And we had a couple bigger seagulls and other hawks and stuff that were coming on campus. And yeah, I'm guessing when they jumped off or something and flew away, it pushed down one side. So the two set screws on this were a little bit loose. So went up, tightened them up again, snugged everything up, rechecked the antenna, make sure everything's okay. But
I thought you were doing fine crankups.
You don't find crankups, exactly. So. You don't climb crane. So yeah, this is the club end of last year, so the club's still doing very well. You see the tower lower in the background, all very happy and excited folks. So yeah, that's pretty much the talk here. Questions, comments? In the back.
You mentioned corrosion. Do you guys ever do any sacrificial anode material?
Sacrificial anode material? No, I haven't. I haven't looked into that much specifically, so. Correct. Yeah, I'm not sure if it works the same way on a tower. I don't think it would.
Well, because our galvanic problems are, every 2-inch bolt step.
Right.
And so
you need quite a bit of sacrificial material to make it work.
Usually
for water, where you have a circulation where it's all in one area, so the ions all flow to that one location. One note on that is the base of the tower, we do the copper connection to the actual tower. That's a galvanized steel connection to a copper connection, and that one's not happy. So you have to be very careful about just some special compound you can use, or you CAD weld it, a bunch of different options. Good luck getting CAD weld. It's an explosive thermite. Other questions? Okay.
Where's your 7.6 repeater located?
7.6 repeater and the 442.3 repeater are both in the administration building on the Cal Poly campus. Those were got new antennas in the last couple of years. So the UHF has a 2-bay folded dipole, and the DHF has a quad-bay folded dipole, and Kenwood TKR 750 and 50.
They're a separate structure.
They're together, separate antennas in the administration.
Separate building.
Just got new controllers.
Thank you.
Other questions?